What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. Suppose we are given an array and asked to find the majority element within it. If we define the majority as an element that appears strictly more than floor of n over 2 times, where n is the total number of elements, the majority element in that array would be 4. When I first encountered this problem, the solution that immediately came to mind involved sorting the array. Why? Well, because if an element is repeated more than n over 2 times, then after sorting the array, that element would inevitably be found in the middle of the array. The implementation of this solution is straightforward. We just sort the array and return the element sitting in the middle of that array. Now, the complexity of the solution is dominated by the sorting, and hence is O of n log n. To optimize it, we will need to trade time for space. Therefore, we will need to make use of maps. Maps allow us to keep track of the elements we have alongside its number of occurrences. For this example, the resulting map will be similar to the one we see. To implement this solution, we must create a hash map. Then we can iterate over the provided numbers and add each number in this map alongside its occurrence. If that number was previously encountered, then the number of occurrences is increased by 1 with the help of the getOrDefaultMap method. After populating the map, we filter it to find the element that appears more than n over 2 times, which gives us the majority element. A small optimization can be done to this method since the answer involves 1 integer only. You see, while populating the map, we can check if the number we are currently at is repeated more than n over 2 times, and if that's the case, we return it. This will prevent going over additional elements after having found the majority one. Okay, this solution is great, runs in linear time, and is kind of optimal. But what if the interviewer prevents us from using additional space, such as the map? How can we solve this problem then? Well, to do that, we will have to explain the Boyer-Moore voting algorithm. Real quick, guys, we've recently launched our membership program on YouTube. We'll keep this very simple. If you're enjoying the content and want to help grow the channel, you can now become a member of the Geekific community by clicking the join button and picking your preferred plan. Now, back to the video. This voting algorithm maintains a single candidate for the majority element and a counter. As we iterate through the array, we increment the counter if the current element matches the candidate, and otherwise, we decrement it. If the counter reaches 0, we select the next element as a new candidate. This algorithm works because the majority element, by definition, appears more frequently than any other element, so it will eventually dominate the count. To visualize this implementation, take this array as an example. While iterating through the elements, we first consider element 4 as the candidate and start by counting its occurrence. The next two elements are also 4, so we increase the count. Next, we have two 1s, so we decrease the counter twice. Upon reaching the sixth element, which is 2, the counter will reset to 0, forcing us to change our candidate in the following iteration to number 3. Now, in the next iteration, we encounter number 4 again, and since it is different than the current candidate, the counter is reset to 0, forcing us to switch the candidate back to 4 in the upcoming iteration. Finally, since the last element is also 4, 4 is voted as the majority element and returned to the user. The Boyer-Moore solution is more efficient in terms of space, with a linear time complexity and constant space. You see, whenever the counter hits 0, the algorithm picks a new candidate. If the previous candidate was not the majority, it would eventually get outvoted. If the majority element is selected as the candidate, it will continue to maintain or regain a positive count as the algorithm processes the array. After the loop ends, the element stored in candidate is guaranteed to be the majority element because its count can't be reduced to 0 in the presence of non-majority elements. Perfect. Now, consider that the majority is no longer represented by more than half of the elements, but by more than 1/3 of them. So the new problem is to return all elements that occur more than floor of n over 3 times in the array. In such arrays, we can have up to 2 majority elements or only 1, since there can be at most 2 elements that appear more than n over 3 times. To tackle this new problem, we will need to adapt our previous algorithms. The maps one is quite easy. All we have to do is replace the n over 2 condition with an n over 3 1. This will return all majority elements in the given array. Another more optimal solution to this problem is adapting the Boyer-Moore voting algorithm. This approach involves tracking 2 potential candidates. To do that, we first need to find the 2 potential candidates. The loop you see is similar to the one we previously wrote for 1 candidate. The same conditions are kept as is, except that they are now being applied to 2 candidates instead of 1. After picking our candidates, we need to count the total occurrence of each candidate before asserting if it is being repeated more than n over 3 times. This is done because the local count we are keeping track of does not represent the total occurrence count of a given candidate. For example, in an array of 10 elements, we could have only two distinct elements, one repeated 8 times and the second 2 times. In such cases, only the one repeated 8 times is considered a majority element and the other one isn't. But in this implementation, both of them will be considered as candidates. And that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.